here we are at week four. Yes, we've begun week four, and tonight we're going to have lecture seven and lecture eight. I'm changing the syllabus just slightly. I will put it on the WebCT as soon as I can access it. And we were talking before class here with the students in class about the fact that I could not access the WebCT tonight in order to put the notes, the class notes for tonight, on there. The site might be down temporarily, is what my guess is. So I'll put those on tomorrow. I'll be in on campus tomorrow, so I'll do that. There were some questions about the WebCT and whether it's important for you to get on it. And the answer is yes, you really need to access the WebCT. For one thing, the midterm is going to be on it. So the midterm will be on the WebCT. We'll post the midterm, and we don't know exactly what form it's going to take because, of course, you have a term paper due at about the time of the midterm. And so that really is going to have a lot more to do with your essay question. And I'm kind of inclined to do some short essays, maybe for the midterm, some short essays and possibly some map questions I might do. But I'll let you know when we get closer to that. It's really only about a month away to the midterm. So to access the WebCT, I think it's www.uh.webct/WebCT. And then you log on, and usually your password is your birth date. It would be two-digit month, two-digit day, and four-digit year. And then once you get on, you can change your password to something else. Okay. Basically, are there any questions about that? Are there any questions about the WebCT? The big advantage to getting on it is we've got links to other sites, is the first advantage. And the second advantage is that I'm putting notes for the lectures on it. So that basically what I'm showing you here, I have printed out on the website. And of course, since this is my research area, I'll be saying a lot more than I'll actually have printed. So you'll need to get more on it. But if you're missing dates or anything of that sort, you can recheck them with the notes on the WebCT. We also have links to some other sites. Okay, about the books. I got in touch with the bookstore again today and asked them why we haven't got our books yet. And so they are trying to check on it, and they're doing as much as they can. I actually sort of raised a fuss with them. Yeah. Press your mic there. Yeah.
They said the publisher was out of William the Conqueror. As I went to Rothers, and they called the publisher, and they said they were out. Mm-hmm. But I've got it coming off Amazon, so.
Okay. That's what I've advised you at this point. Go on to Amazon.com or go on to some of the other bookstores. Try the used bookstores and see if you can get hold of them. You don't have to have the new edition. The old one will do. All right. The other book that we have to worry about is this one by Elizabeth Van Hoots, The Normans in Europe. And this is a collection of sources, and I was looking at this as our textbook. The latest news I've heard on this is the bookstore originally got 25 copies. They have now sold them, and they can't get any more. Okay, so that's the bad news. All right. Again, I've used this several years in a row here in Houston. So there must be used copies floating around Houston, and I would try the internet for used copies. If you can't get it, don't worry. We'll just do library research, and you will save your money on those. Luckily, in the past 10 years, almost all the major works on the Normans have been retranslated, and their new editions are available, and we have most of them in our library. The library at Rice University has everything, virtually everything. It's a splendid library, and you can get a hold of practically anything there that we need for the Middle Ages. So what we'll do, if we can't, for those of you who can't get a hold of this, is to make it more of a research paper And if you just can't get this book, then I'll try to use it more and read more from it as we go through the lectures, because it's a wonderful book and I really love it. I'm really unhappy that it's gone out of print. I hope they'll redo it. All right, so in two different phases, we're going to look at 1066, the year of the conquest, and first we're going to look at the Norman version as shown in the bio tapestry and augmented by many of the other texts that there are about it. The reason I'm going to give you the Norman version first is because it's pictorial and we can follow the lines of the whole story. And then in the second hour, I want to backtrack and look at the Anglo-Saxon version and the rationale for believing that one. The problem with the Norman conquest is we've got two contradictory stories, one from England, one from Normandy. Some facts we can corroborate, others we simply cannot. And I think we really can't know exactly what happened. Although I'm feeling a little more certain as I went over all this material in the past 3 days, I've changed my opinion and I've come to a kind of different conclusion than I had when I started, just by reviewing it all in one glop here, I guess you would say. So I'll give you some of my insights, but you all can make up your own mind, and I'm going to try to leave time at the end for you all to give your opinions, and we'll discuss it a little bit. I see that we have three sites that we have people in. The one with four of you, that must be Sugarland, right? Fort Bend? Oh, five of you, Fort Bend. Can you hear me? Can you talk? Can you, is Christopher there? My contact? Yes, I see Christopher waving. Okay, Christopher, could you email me? Go ahead and email me the roll sheet because we're taking roll. Now, who is the other person who is there? Is that North Houston? Yes, there you are. Where are you? Where are you located?
Woodlands.
Woodlands. Okay, but we can't hear you. All right. The other room seems to be empty. I don't see anyone in the other room, but there's someone else at the Woodlands, so that there's somebody else. Okay, remember that if we can get microphone contact, you all are free to ask questions as well as everyone else. All right, let's turn to... Oh, okay, could you all try one more time at the Woodlands? Try at the Woodlands. Can you talk to us?
Do you copy?
Yes, we copy. We read you here at Houston Central. Good.
Excellent.
I
had a quick question for you. I showed up right as you were saying, if you can't get a hold of this, then something, because, yeah.
Oh, all right.
What were you talking about?
I was talking about the Normans in Europe, which is the book that I have thought of as our textbook, and it appears that it's now out of print. Originally, there were 25 copies in the bookstore. They've all been sold. And so try to get it online or at used bookshops. If you can't, then treat your paper as more of a research paper.
Okay, I've got that book.
Good for you.
But I don't have the I can't get the William the Conqueror book.
Okay, that is on order again. Again, try through the used online places. And we hope it's coming in. I called the library again today and they're checking on it. They're going to try as hard as they can to get it for us. So if you can't get these books, we'll treat it as a research topic. Okay? Go to the library.
So we can just research in other books about William the Conqueror, and that will be sufficient?
Yes. Uh-huh. And there is so much published. There's so much out there. It's a really popular topic, so you won't have any trouble getting books. And I suggested that you go to the library here. You go to the library at Rice University. They have virtually everything. The downtown library in Houston has a lot of books on the Normans and the Vikings. So you shouldn't have any trouble getting books.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
And you might save some money. Okay. Where are we? Sugar Land. Fort Bend.
We're here if you can hear us.
Yes, we can now hear you. Okay, good. Okay, remember that you can ask questions as we go along, too. All right, Christopher.
We may lose audio again. We've got a lot of static and harmonic distortion out here.
A lot of static. All right. Did you hear that, Don?
No, the desktop mic. Somebody.
Okay, we're working on it. All right, we're going to look at the Norman version, and we'll look at the Bayeux Tapestry because we have lots of pictures. There are a lot of sources on the Norman side. There are so many written sources because the conquest caused such a stir. It was such a heroic event all over Europe, not just in England and in Normandy, but all over Europe. Everybody noticed, and this was something that was really catching people's attention. So a lot of people in France wrote about the Norman conquest. A lot of Normans wrote about it, and a lot of Englishmen wrote about it. And so the first set of sources I'm going to go through are the French and Norman sources. And the earliest source that I could find, and I sort of went through all of these again, is the Carmen de Hastingai Proelia by Guy, Bishop of Amiens. And this is out in a new edition. This is it, by Guy of Amiens. And it's been revamped and rethought, and a new introduction has been written. Oxford Medieval Texts has a lot of these books, and of course England is particularly conscious of its own history. This is an epic poem, and it was written before 11 May 1068. So clearly this is the earliest version. It's almost an eyewitness account written right after the Norman conquest, which was in 1066, of course. Guy was not exactly a Norman. He was related to Guy of Ponthieu, and Guy Count of Ponthieu, who was actually his uncle, who lived in the county of Ponthieu, which is, we'll see it on a map in a moment. It's to the northeast of Normandy and very close to England. It's in the area we think of as Frisia. Remember there were a lot of Vikings who settled in Frisia. Guy was related in his family relations to Eustace of Boulogne, who was the count of the county of Boulogne right next to Ponthieu. He was related to William the Conqueror, and he was related to Edward the Confessor. So he was linked through kinship to many of the key actors of this play. He was a very distinguished scholar of the Abbey of San Riquier. And he had traveled widely. He had been on a mission to Rome in 1049 and had attended the coronation of King Philip I of France in 1059. He actually died in December 1075. And as the earliest account, the authors, the editors who have edited this, it's a poem about the Battle of Hastings and how the battle went and everything, but the editors believe that it's a fuller, more honest, and more reliable account than the Gesta Guillelmi or the Gesta Normannorum Ducum, which we're going to talk about in a moment. And they also say that it's more explicit than the Bayeux Tapestry, so that if you were to take this book and put it side by side with the Bayeux Tapestry, you could cross-check the various accounts that are given. And since it's the earliest account, only 2 years have gone by, and there hasn't been time for all the embellishment that inevitably came to be done on this story of the conquest of Normandy. So this is a wonderful account and a very early account. Okay. A-M-I-E-N-S. Yeah, Amiens. All right. And I should have a map to show you where that is. All right, here I've colored it for you. Here is our map of Normandy, and my picture is cutting it off. Here is the Duchy of Amiens, and here is Ponthieu right up here And just north of that is Boulogne. And so they're right up here in this area that is Frisia, right next to Normandy. And in fact, this is where William Longsword was killed in this area, fighting to really get control of that area. The Normans never succeeded in taking over that area. So that's where he was, and so he's right next to Normandy. He would be in a very good place to know all about it. William of Poitiers wrote the Gesta Guillaume right after that. William of Poitiers, my new computer won't do accents. He was a Norman from Preaux, born around 1020 and died after 1087. And 1087, of course, is the death date of William the Conqueror. His sister became abbess of Saint-Léger de Preaux, and which had been founded by Roger of Beaumont. And Roger of Beaumont was one of the chief men who was in the entourage of William the Conqueror. He was one of the chief advisors, and he was very prominent in the government of William the Conqueror before and after the conquest. He was the one who was left to take care of the duchy when William went to England to conquer England. So he was left in charge. He and the queen, not the queen, but he and the Duchess Matilda were left in charge, and his 16-year-old son, Robert of Beaumont, fought in the Battle of Hastings. So this is a very prominent family with a lot of close ties. And so William of Poitiers then would have been in a position to really know what was going on. William of Poitiers may well have been a vassal of the Beaumonts, and he started out his life as a knight. He wasn't destined for the church, but he started as a knight, and he had the typical education of a young man in Normandy, which is to take up arms at the age of 7 years old, learn how to ride a horse, and learn how to fight with the arms that he had. But then, as he reached the top of his prime in really knighthood and became a very famous knight, then he turned to the church, saying that the knightly life was not for him, and so he began to study at St. Hilaire le Grand in Poitiers in France. And this is interesting with his connection to the Normans and the Norman conquest, because the Church of St. Hilaire, or St. Hilaire, was built largely at the expense of Queen Emma of England. And so she was the major patron of that church where he got his education. So we can expect him to have an affinity to the Normans in many different directions. He then returned to Normandy to become the Archdeacon of Lisieux, which is in the eastern part of Normandy. And he was an archdeacon under Bishop Hugh, who died in 1077, and also under Bishop Gilbert Mamenot, who was the next bishop of Lisieux. And William of Poitiers was also a chaplain of Duke William the Bastard, or William the Conqueror. So he had very close ties, and we can expect him to give you a really Norman, a pro-Norman point of view here. He wrote almost immediately after the conquest, bringing the story up to 1071, but he left it unfinished at that point. Probably he wrote between 1071 and 1077, and William the Conqueror apparently asked him to expand the story and write more. William of Jumièges is the next person we'll look at, and let me show you William of Poitiers. This is the Gesta Guillaume of William of Poitiers. For a long time, this was only available in a French translation or in the original Latin, but this is a fairly new translation that's come out that now you can read in English. And of course, all of these Oxford medieval texts that I'm showing you are facing translations with the Latin on one side and the English on the other. And they're done by very good people. The next person we have is the Gesta Normannorum Ducum by William of Jumièges, who was a monk of the Abbey of Jumièges and an eyewitness of some of the events of the reign of Duke Richard III from 1026 to 1027 onward. William of Jumièges was born about the year 1000. And Orderic, interestingly, gives his nickname as William Calculus. And that has been interpreted to mean not that he did calculus, but that he calculated the sums of their income, of the income of the abbey, and took track of what their income was and how they spent it. He was an accountant, a CPA or something like that, in other words. So that's why he's named William Calculus. He wrote The Gesta Normannorum Ducum over about 20 years, and he started by giving a history of all the Norman dukes going back to the first Norman dukes based on an abbreviation of Dudo of Saint-Quentin, who we've mentioned before. But Dudo is largely legendary, and the richness of William of Jumièges' Gesta Normannorum Ducum is that it's not just about the dukes, but it's also about all the leading families of Normandy. And so you can go in, and he's just obsessed with family history and who married whom and how many children did they have and who did those children marry and what did they do. And so he was really obsessed with tracing these families. And so this strikes us immediately as something that's distinctively Norman, the sense of kinship and kin relationships that are so important to the Normans. Okay, and here is the Gesta Normannorum Ducum. It exists in two modern volumes. This is volume one. And there are interpolations by Orderic Vitalis and Robert of Torigny. Orderic Vitalis wrote a century later, and Robert of Torigny wrote even a century after that. So I find the most trustworthy thing to do is go through it and look to see what William of Jumièges says. Mm-hmm.
Even though they're translated, they're still considered primary sources?
Oh, yes, yes. I mean, I don't expect you, I mean, I can't require you all to know Latin, to read them in the original Latin, yeah?
And this is in English, available in English?
Yes, this is a facing translation. It's all copyrighted, so I can't really show you. I mean, I could...
Ben Hooch has done it, right?
Yeah, on the left page, there'll be the Latin, and on the right page, there'll be the English, and you can, if you know Latin, you can correlate them all. And so it's very nice to have. Okay. 15 seconds don't count on copyrights, all right? Here we go. 15 seconds, start counting. Here's the English, and here's the Latin, okay? So this is about Queen Gerberga here, who. Yes, and there is Queen Gerberga, who heard her husband, that her husband had been taken prisoner by the king. Okay, so all of these books I'm showing you are done in that way. And so it helps a lot to be able to cross-check it. It helps to be able to read it fast in English and then go check the Latin if you're not sure of something and you wonder what is the original Latin. Yeah.
Say Oxford Medieval?
Oxford Medieval Texts, yes. Uh-huh. And these are here you can see the Oxford Medieval Texts. This is the series that they're all in. All right. Now, by the early 1050s, William of Jumièges had begun revisions of it and probably finished the first version before 1060. But at the request of Duke William, he added an account of the Norman conquest, which he finished early in 1070. So, because he's writing in 1070, that's only 4 years after the Norman conquest. And so he really knew what was going on. And this is almost an eyewitness account. He died in an unknown time after 1070. Yes, question. Jason, are you Jason?
No, I'm
Robert. Okay, Robert.
Oh, why did he undertake revisions?
Well, because good writers always revise. I mean, when scholars write a book, they revise sometimes 10 times, and so the more you revise, the more concise it is, and the more perfect it is. And so they were taught in the monastery to write in that way. That's a good question, by the way.
Yeah. Could it be that some of the Normans didn't like what he'd written and wanted him to rewrite it so that they wouldn't look so bad?
No, No, he didn't. He was fully pro-Norman. There was no question about that. Do you remember the Abbey of Jumièges that we mentioned when we talked about the Normans? It was one of those reformed abbeys that had been restored, and there was a school there, and so scholars were there, and they had scholarly ethics, just like we do now, and rules for how to write. Yeah, question.
Is he the one that wrote somewhat critically about the ancestors, the Viking stage of their history?
He wrote somewhat, well, all of them did. I mean, all of them denied, especially the churchmen, denied that they were Viking anymore. But when you sort of read between the lines, you see that they are. Okay. So he died at an unknown time after 1070. Now, and this is the initial first letter to the history of William of Jumièges. All right, and it has this picture of a king receiving a copy of the book, probably King William. Okay, now, the biotapestry. Clearly, the biotapestry is a very important, so I'll just have to hold that, is a very important record, and there are about 400 books published about the biotapestry. They've been written about endlessly, and probably no topic in English history has been debated as much as the Norman Conquest or as much as the biotapestry. With written records, we can take the words and we can look at the sentences and we can try to interpret what they say. But with pictorial evidence, it multiplies 100-fold the different ways that you can interpret what the story says. And so it's all, you know, and it's like your guess is as good as mine. You can know everything about the Normans, and you read it, you read the thing like a document, and you try to figure out what happened. The book I use, and as I said, there are 400 books published. At the time this book was published, there were 400 books published about the biotapestry. This is the one I have assigned, and since we can't seem to get hold of our required books, this is an optional book for you. You might want to go ahead and buy this book. I'm pretty sure it's in the bookstore. It's a lovely book, and it's the entire biotapestry in pictures with a text that has a scholarly argument about where what it means and how do you interpret it. And so you can get the background on all the different interpretations of the biotapestry, which we can't go through here, but you can see where he's coming from. And Wolfgang Grape is an extraordinarily gifted art historian who has made an extremely persuasive argument that is quite different from the arguments that have been made in the past about the biotapestry. And here you can see some of the colors in it that are so beautiful. And of course, we can see they took their horses with them. This is William the Conqueror's ship that has this great Viking masthead on it, and they took their horses on the ship with them. No, they're typical Viking ships. Okay, he argues that the biotapestry originated in Bayeux itself. It used to be conjectured that it was an English document, that the English had actually embroidered it. But when we say tapestry, it's not a woven tapestry like the tapestries that you're used to thinking about, but rather it is embroidery. It's a strip of linen, a very long strip of linen, and the pictures are embroidered. Well, actually, it's about between 2.5 and 3 feet high, almost 3 feet, and really, really long. And so it's been conjectured that it was made to hang around a hall, so or a palace. Now, and so Wolfgang Grape discusses whether it was made to be put around a hall, a church, the interior of a church, or around a palace. And he really comes to the conclusion that it's a palace, not a church that it was made for. He discusses at great length whether it's a religious document or not, because it's called the biotapestry. Well, it has several different names. It has the name in France of the Tapisserie de la Reine, the Queen's tapestry, Queen Matilda's tapestry. So it's associated with occur in France. Traditionally, it's been thought that it was made by Odo, Bishop of Bayeux, who was the brother of William the Conqueror, and he made it for his church in Bayeux to hang on the church as propaganda and as a sort of tribute to himself as the brother of the conqueror, as well as being tribute to the conqueror. He believed that it was made in Bayeux itself, not in England, as was previously thought, because the Bayeux tapestry has marginalia. There's a main scene in the middle, and let's sort of go to that in a minute. Do we have it? Well, this is the main scene. And then we'll see that in the other pictures, there'll be a border along the top and a border along the bottom that'll be commenting about the events in the main stream of the tapestry. It used to be thought that there were English rebels who were embroidering it and who were then commenting on the Normans and these horrible Normans who had attacked them. And some of them are quite risque. I mean, they're interesting, risque little pictures in the margins. And so the question is, not only how do we interpret the main story, but how do we interpret the margins as well? And so there's quite a bit more that has to be done with it. So it used to be think that English rebels were making snide comments in the margins against the Normans, and that he really debunks. He says that's not true at all. His argument is brilliant and persuasive, and he is a student of some of the best historians, best art historians of European medieval art that there are. And what he argues is that what was at stake was auctoritas, the rule of the conquerors, and that it's a propaganda document that is meant to extol the greatness and the rightness of the Norman conquest. It's a work of Norman pictorial propaganda, commissioned by the conqueror's brother, Bishop Odo. And it's interesting that after the conquest, Bishop Odo, who was a bishop in Normandy, was also made Earl of Kent in England, which meant he had a secular role and he was a commander of the army in Kent. And as we'll see, that's a very important position that he had. Well, it was finished before 1082, when Odo was imprisoned for rebelling against William, so that it's quite an early document and it's almost contemporary as well. One thing about it that we can notice is it's a piece of cloth that is portable. And once you have this long strip of cloth, not only is it more enduring than other forms of art, but it's also portable. You can roll it up and you can take it from place to place. And this is essentially what he was arguing, was that it was a portable, triumphal monument and that the Normans would roll it up and then they would take it to different cities and display it, whether in England or Normandy, and show pictorially the exciting events of the Norman conquest and the rationale behind them all. Yeah, comment.
I've heard that during the French Revolution, they took it out of, I guess, wherever it was, the Louvre or mm-hmm. where have you, mm-hmm. and they were going to cut it up and use it to decorate the bottoms of their floats in the parade, and they wound up just wrapping it around this one float many, many, many times, as opposed to actually cutting it up.
The story I had heard was that they had wrapped it around a cannon in the French Revolution, that they wrapped it around a cannon and they and that it had grease on it, and you know it was to protect the cannon, and that part of the end of it was ripped off, which is true, part of the end of it is ripped off. But it was only saved by a fluke, just a mere fluke, that whoever saw it wrapped around this cannon recognized what it was and rescued it. And so otherwise it would have been lost forever. Yeah, comment.
Are there other examples of this used by other dynasties, of this type of propaganda work?
Excellent question. Yes. Last week, and I meant to dig that picture out, but last week I showed you a tapestry that came from the Oseberg ship in Norway. And there was a tapestry that is very, very reminiscent of the Bayeux tapestry. It has horses in it, it has wagons, it has very many of the same features that we see in the Bayeux tapestry. I'll try to remember to bring it next week again and show it to you again. Oseberg, O-S-E. Here, I'll write that down for you. Okay. Oseberg ship burial. It's a ship burial of a queen in Norway. Yeah, question.
Actually, I have two. Okay. The first is, I don't know what you mean by propaganda. To me, when you say propaganda, it kind of has the connotation of misleading a public for political gain. And so
exactly.
I don't know if you mean to say that the tapestry was a lie or not. And that's the first question. And the second question is, without kind of a continuous propaganda machine, I guess is what you would need, how effective was the propaganda, given that they're just traveling from town to town, showing them this tapestry and moving on?
It was very effective. It was propaganda, first of all. Propaganda doesn't have to be a total lie. Most propaganda has a germ of truth to it.
Most of it is based with a kernel of truth surrounded by, you know, the rest of it being a lie. That's what makes it so believable. It's like, well, this part is true. Why isn't the rest, you know, why shouldn't the rest be?
Sure. It's what we call spin.
Yeah.
And we're hearing a lot of it now from the political campaigns that we're listening to. Yeah, we have the same set of facts, and one group gives it this twist, and the other group gives it this other twist, and that's exactly what the Normans are doing.
Mm-hmm. I guess propaganda is definitely part of selling yourself and marketing in terms of political machinery.
Yes, absolutely, and that's what the Normans did. And they had to use this. Actually, Judith Brown gave a wonderful paper at the Haskin Society 2 years ago in which she argued that it was taken around England and displayed to the English to sell them on the conquest, to say, here we are. Look how wonderful we are. We've conquered you, and now we're going to rule you.
Hearts and minds,
yes. And so, so she argued it was taken around England, but equally, I think it was also taken around Normandy, because of course they would want the people back home to know of the heroic exploits of conquering England. And of course, once the Normans conquered England, England was the richest country in all of Europe, and just tons of wealth poured back into Normandy. Normandy became instantly nouveau riche in terms of all the areas of Europe. And so it made a very big impact on the Normans at home as well as on the English. And so this propaganda would have uses for all of them. And I'm sure that it was very carefully prepared and very carefully used for these propagandistic things. Why put it up in the palace in Bayeux and make everyone travel to it? You can just roll it up and take it wherever you want to display it, just like we do art displays in this country now, from one museum to another. And so this is I think that Wolfgang Grape makes quite a persuasive argument that this is what they're doing. Yeah.
Are there negative propaganda work that other dynasties or some of their enemies might put out?
Yes, and that's why we're doing two lectures tonight, one on the Norman version and one on the English version, because there will be an English version. Yeah.
It also served a purpose similar to the use of stained glass windows, a method of teaching at a time when most people were illiterate.
Yes. Well, yes and no. I mean, I would argue that a lot of people were literate, especially the ruling class, the Normans. I've written an article on that and made an argument that people have found persuasive, that these Normans who went to conquer England were embarking on making their culture literate, and that many of these people had gone to school. And they're not churchmen, they're laymen, they're soldiers who fought in the Battle of Hastings, and they could read and write, they were literate. So, but then there are still people who are not literate, and as a work of art, this work is so lively and so gorgeous, and you can see the story with a powerful impact. So it would serve the purpose of a movie today, that if one of our candidates for president were to make a movie telling about the story of his life and how what a wonderful war hero he was, for example, that's the kind of purpose it would serve, and it is a powerful document.
It's a multimedia approach, I guess.
Yes, a multimedia approach, right, in the Middle Ages. Yeah, comment.
Isn't there also an argument that the people of the 11th century weren't quite as media savvy and weren't necessarily as likely to disbelieve it as propaganda as someone from the 21st century would be?
No. The answer is no, because they knew what the truth was. It's just the same way you have spin today in politics, that you can interpret something in various ways. And so there you can interpret the same set of facts in different ways. Yeah.
I was going to say, for the masses of people, for, you know, the great majority, it's generally, you know, same stuff, different ruler. It's, you know, for them, it's better the devil you know than the devil you don't know.
Well, that opens another question altogether about who were the peasants and what was their position and how dumb were they, and my conclusion I have reached, and I'm not able to go through the proof of this for you adequately in this class, but my view, after studying this for 20 years, is that we don't have rigid class divisions in Normandy before the conquest. And this is substantiated by the legal code and what is her name who wrote that book? I'm forgetting right now. But everything was very fluid in Normandy, including class lines. And there was not a big division between the rich and the poor, because everybody was relatively poor before the Norman conquest. It's only after the Norman conquest that you see the aristocrats rise to a much higher height than the peasants, because before the conquest, they're all relatively equal. They're poor farmers and landowners, and you can't separate them. I mean, they're just beginning, that aristocracy is just beginning its rise. Yeah.
And the question ought to be also, we talk about masses a lot today, that we assume that it is important to talk to the masses all the time. In the 10th century, in the 11th and 12th centuries, was it really that necessary to talk to the masses all the time, or are people talking within the aristocratic lines?
That's an interesting question. And the answer to it, I believe, is that in Normandy before the conquest, and possibly in England as well, because of that Viking heritage and the coal class setup where you have these free farmers who are relatively equal, you don't have rigid class systems. And there's a big argument about whether the Normans brought feudalism to England. Now I'm forgetting his name too. I'm leaping around all these things, but there's a book about the social classes in England, lords and thanes in pre-conquest England, in Anglo-Saxon England, by Richard Abels wrote that book. And he never comes out and says it, but England is so like Normandy. I mean, if you defined what feudalism was and you read his description, you would say England was feudal. And they're not that different. The two major differences between England and Normandy are that Normandy had mounted combat soldiers and castles, and England did not. They fought on foot. They rode horses, but they fought on foot, and they didn't have castles. They had burgs, or fortified cities, instead of castles, which are fortified in the countryside. Yeah, question. Press. No question. Okay, let's charge ahead here. Okay. The Biotapestry shows the story of Norman victory in enthralling detail, and it's a wonderful piece of art. It's so exciting and so dramatic and beautifully rendered. I mean, one looks at it and just you're just gripped by it. It's an effective instrument of pictorial propaganda, history through Norman eyes. And I wanted to show you this wall painting that came from Normandy at the time. It's 11th or 12th century, and And the question is, why, that Wolfgang Grape raises is, why didn't they just paint a fresco or a mural on the wall? I mean, if they wanted to show the Norman conquest, why did they do a tapestry? And so there are two answers to that question, one of which he doesn't give, but one is that it's a Viking tradition to do tapestries, as we saw in the Oseberg ship. The second answer is that if you do it as a tapestry, you can carry it around. You make it transportable so that you can use it as a propaganda machine. They were very skilled at making murals. They could have done it as a mural, and they chose not to do it. Okay, and so the other theme that's in the bio tapestry is it's the history of God acting through men. And this is a theme of the Norman church at the time. And in the bio tapestry, for the first time, we really see expressed a sense of national identity for the Normans, a historical self-awareness. So immediately my question to Wolfgang Grape would be, if I met him, I would say, well, is this the moment the Normans became Norman, when they did this great heroic deed of conquering England, and suddenly they became conscious of their own identity? And that's my inclination to think that's a real possibility, to say, this is the moment. They're still kind of Viking, and my teacher, C. Warren Hollister, used to say, well, the Norman conquest was the last great Viking raid. And so, but it can be both. Why can't it be both? The last Viking raid, and also the moment when the Normans became conscious of their own identity as separate from the English and from the Vikings as Normans. And here is Bishop Robert, who is, here is William, Duke William, and here is Bishop Robert, Bishop Odo, who is his brother, and this is Robert. I think this is Robert of Montgomery, who's portrayed here. And so here they are, the two brothers, the heroes of the bio tapestry. Now we have Orderic Vitalis, who wrote quite a bit later, but he wrote a magnificent work of history, and this is the ecclesiastical history of Orderic Vitalis. This is volume 2. He actually, it comes in 6 modern volumes. It's a huge work, and I've described a little bit of it to you before, but I wanted to tell you a little bit about Orderic. He was of mixed Norman and English descent. His father was Odalarius of Orleans, a priest in the household of Roger of Montgomery. And Roger of Montgomery, of course, was a Norman in Normandy. Orderic's mother was English, and so he's a product of the conquest. And he was born near Shrewsbury in 1075. At the age of 10, Orderic became a monk of the Abbey of Saint-Evroul in Normandy. And his earliest written work was interpolations into the history of William of Jumièges around 1109. So I showed you this Gesta Normannorum Ducum of William of Jumièges, and Orderic wrote some glosses into it, some comments in it, as he copied it. Okay. He began his great work, The Ecclesiastical History, as the story of Saint-Evroul, and he was just going to do a little local story of Saint-Evroul beginning in the first decade of the 12th century. And then, as he wrote and he wrote and he wrote, and it widened into a history of the whole Norman church, and then it widened even more into a history of the Normans in the great wide world. And so he knew what was going on everywhere. He wrote about the First Crusade, and he wrote about what was happening there. He knew everything that was going on. He knew what the Normans were doing in Italy and Sicily, and he knew. Now, if you all can't find the other primary sources, you could read Orderic Vitalis, especially Volume 2 and Volume 3, if you wanted to know everything the Normans were doing. And he knew what was going on all over Scandinavia, which is something that really amazes me. He knew what was going on in Germany. He knew what was going on in Flanders. I mean, here he was, this little monk sitting in a monastery. He didn't travel very much, and he found out everything. And the other thing he does that's really quite extraordinary is that he traces virtually every person in the Norman aristocracy, so that you can go through his index and you can find every single Norman family and who they're married to and who their children were and who their fathers were and where they lived and what they did. And it's a massive history of everybody who did anything in Normandy. It's very difficult to read because he jumps all over the place and he goes into these, you know, these side stories, these side issues, and then he says, okay, now back to the main topic. So it's kind of hard to read, but it's a wonderful piece of work. Yeah.
Do you have archives to work with, or would he interview people?
Marjorie Chibnall is the translator of Orderic Vitalis, and here it is. You can see my copy is well used. Marjorie Chibnall translated this, and she is the great expert on Orderic Vitalis. We can track him down in several trips that he made. He went to England. He traveled a bit in Normandy, but there are only about five trips that he makes during his life. And mostly he talked to people who came to St. Evroul. And he also had contact with the family at St. Evroul, which sent a lot of people to Italy and had people that went on crusade. And so she thinks he interviewed them as they came back to St. Evroul, and he had contacts with them. He also had library sources. He drew on William of Poitiers. He drew on William of Jumièges. And so he also used books as sources. Some lost works we've been able to identify through reading his book. Okay. But primarily, it's a family history of Norman families. And the most extraordinary thing to me about this book is, well, it's not extraordinary when you think about it. Now, let me see if you can see why. But only one manuscript survives of this great historical work, and it's the autograph manuscript. It's the one Orderic wrote himself, and that's the only one that survives. Where is it located now? I think it's in, I'm not sure where it is, Bibliothèque Nationale in Paris, probably, when the monasteries were broken up after the French Revolution. It is. I'll see if I can find where the manuscript is.
Now, is this when they still rolled the manuscripts?
No, they were written as books. They were written as books. Yeah, that's a good question, actually. Well, I'll see if I can look that up during the break. We don't have time right now. But there's only one manuscript, and it's the autograph manuscript. And that says to me that not very many people read it. Because when something was read very widely, there are hundreds of manuscripts scattered all over Europe. And if there's only one, that means that not very many people read it. So that's kind of interesting, too. Absolutely, it does. It compares very well with Bede's, and Bede could easily have been one of the models for it. The difference is that there are hundreds of manuscripts of Bede and not of Orderic Vitalis. And I would guess that Bede did inspire him, and that because the church was very, there were copies of Bede in all the Norman monasteries, and so they knew about him. Yeah, question.
Well, that is very strange because, I mean, you've been going on along about how important history has been for the Normans. Mm-hmm. And where this is a history of Norman families, it is unusual that it wouldn't have been widely read. Unless, of course, he never released it to anyone but himself.
Well, there's no question of release. My opinion is, and it's only an opinion, is that it's so massive, you know, that you it would take a lifetime to copy it, and so you couldn't really copy it enough to send it around to all these places. It's just too big. But it is a national treasure of France. It's so extraordinary. According to the Norman version of the story of the conquest of England, the story really begins with the marriage of Emma, who we talked about, the sister of Duke Richard II and the daughter of Duke Richard I, her marriage to King Ethelred Unred of England. And she had three children, Alfred, Edward, and Godgifu, or Goda. I tend to call her Goda, although Elizabeth Van Hoots usually calls her Godgifu, and she spells it differently. All of these names are spelled in lots of different ways. Okay, there's no standard spelling of them. So you have to cross-check. You might think you have two people when you only have one. Okay. Now, Goda married Drew, Count of the Vexin, in Normandy. And then secondly, she married Eustace, Count of Boulogne. Okay, and we'll see how that fits in. In 1033, Duke Robert sent a fleet to restore Edward to England. And he tried to put Edward back on the throne because Edward was his nephew. Canute, at that point, was King of England and offered to restore half of England. And here is Emma, who married Ethelred, and here she's receiving a letter, and here she's crossing the sea to go to England in an English boat. Well, Edward then started witnessing documents in Normandy as King of the English at Mont Saint-Michel is the first place he witnesses a document. And then only 2 years later, Canute died. And Alfred sailed to England, but he was killed treacherously on his arrival. And the Normans, uniformly in every single one of these histories, the Normans blame Godwin, Earl Godwin of Wessex. And they blame him that he treacherously and deceitfully promised to protect Alfred, and instead he murdered him. Edward had been poised to sail to England with a fleet at that moment in 1035, but when he heard that his brother had been murdered, he turned back and he decided he didn't have enough troops to defeat the English. So instead, we had the accession of Harold Harefoot, who was the son of Canute by Alfgifu, his Norwegian wife, and so he ruled for about 5 years, and then he died mysteriously. Lots of mysterious deaths at this point, and we know none of the details about how or why they died. And they're young guys. Hartha Canute then left Norway. He had been king of Norway, and he came and became king of England in 1040 to 1042, and he also died a mysterious death at a very young age. At this point, Emma and Earl Godwin joined forces to install Edward as king, and they had worked together to really bring Hartha Canute there. And in fact, before they installed before Hartha Canute died, they had persuaded him to make Edward a co-king, co-rulers of the kingdom, and split the kingdom up between the two of them. So that when Hartha Canute died, there still were a lot of claimants to the English throne, but Emma and Godwin were able to get Edward in there as king. They persuaded the Witan, they persuaded the archbishops of Canterbury and York, and Edward was crowned king in 1043. And here is Edward sitting on the throne of England as the king, and here he is as king. This is a famous picture of him. Here are these borders, by the way, that I was telling you about that have these interesting interesting clues to what's going on. The crucial year, as we said last time, was 1051. And, you know, often when modern historians try to piece together the true story of the Norman conquest, they try to take the different English accounts and the different Normans' accounts and somehow weave them together into the one true story. You can't do it. You can't do it. It's really hard to do it. I mean, because we don't know what the truth is. But it's very clear in looking at all the sources that 1051 was a crucial year. And I'll just give you my interpretation of what happened. And this would be, I think, from the Norman perspective as well. Edward banished the Godwins from England, and they had been sent out on sort of trumped-up charges. And this is the point where the Norman sources claim that Edward promised England to Duke William. The Godwins, Edward was almost a prisoner of the Godwins, and the Norman sources don't show him that way, but I think he was. He had a few Normans with him in England, and at this point he made Robert of Jumièges the Archbishop of Canterbury. Robert of Jumièges had been the Bishop of London. And at this point, this important marriage was made between Eustace, Count of Boulogne, and Goda, the sister of Edward the Confessor. In that very same year, William married Matilda of Flanders, and that was a smart move because then the Counts of Flanders would be his allies. And this argues for the truth of this matter that Edward had named William as his heir, and William was now preparing to fortify himself with allies in Flanders by marrying the daughter of the Count of Flanders. But now the church throws a monkey wrench into it. Just at that point in 1051, there was a new pope in Rome, and this new pope was Leo IX, and he is known as the first moderate reform pope. He placed Normandy under interdict, but Lanfranc of Bec, who we've mentioned before, just happened to be in Rome at that time, allying himself with the Reform papacy. And this was to have an enormous impact on Normandy because it probably was Lanfranc who told Leo IX that there were some questionable kinship ties between William and Matilda. In fact, she was the stepdaughter of one of his aunts, okay? And if you track that down, there was really not a consanguineous tie between them, a tie of blood. But if you didn't know the lineage perfectly, you would think there was because her father had been married to William's aunt at one time, even though she was the daughter of a different wife of the Count of Flanders, Baldwin the of Flanders. So I think it was a mistake that Lanfranc made. Nevertheless, it had a huge impact on the church because interdict means that you can't have any church services in Normandy. And so this had an impact. The following year, the Godwins returned to Normandy, to England. And what they did was come back with an army. And they had an army. They actually invested all the sea towns, the coastal towns of England. And Edward the Confessor knew that he was beaten without a battle. I mean, he didn't even bother to fight because clearly they had the upper hand. And so the Godwins then came back and took over everything. Archbishop Robert was banished to Normandy, and the Normans claimed instead, from their point of view, they claimed that Edward sent him to Normandy to tell William that William was going to be the heir to England. Okay, so they twisted the facts in the stories. But it looks to me like what's happening in England is the Godwins come in with an iron fist, and they've got Edward where they want him, and they make him do what they want. When Archbishop Robert was banished to Normandy, this meant that there was no Archbishop of Canterbury. I mean, because the rule of the church is if you're an archbishop, you're archbishop for life. You can never be deposed. You can never step down. You're archbishop for life. And the Archbishop of Canterbury is the head of the English church, the most important churchman in England. Now, they banished him and sent him to England, and then the Godwins put their own man in as archbishop. This would be Stigand, a Viking, who was consecrated Archbishop of Canterbury. Now, what do you think the church is going to say about that, especially Leo IX in Rome? What's the opinion going to be? This is illegal. Stigand is not really the Archbishop of Canterbury. He's making a false claim. He is a falsifier. and this is a heinous crime. The Normans claim that this is illegal, and they make a big deal of this religious causation, that here are these horrible Anglo-Saxons who don't even know how the Reformed Church works, and they've got an illegal archbishop as the head of the English Church. Clearly, blasphemy is going on in England, and this is anti-Christian. They're not any good. So this is the Norman propaganda about Stigand. Now, Lanfranc of Bec uses this political situation, and he was a master politician. He used the political situation. Now, William was kind of desperate. He had already married Matilda in 1051, and he wanted her as his, I mean, she was his wife. He had legally married her. And so how was he going to square things with the church? Well, Lanfranc came in and said, okay, you have done something wrong, which is to marry without the permission of the church, and so your penance will be that you will build two huge and very rich ducal monasteries and endow them with tons of wealth, and you will build them in the new city of Caen, one for men and one for women. And once you do this penance, then the Pope will forgive you and allow you to be married. Okay, so William began to build the twin abbeys at Caen, and they were actually completed in 1063. The two abbeys are La Trinité for women and Saint Etienne for men. And then Lanfranc became the abbot of Saint Etienne. He had not been abbot of Bec. He was prior of Bec. And here are these abbeys. Here are drawings of them. This is La Trinité for women. And actually, one of William the Conqueror's daughters became the abbess of La Trinité. And here is Saint Etienne, the abbey for men. And Lanfranc became the abbot. And this is the first monumental architecture built in Normandy. These are magnificent churches, very huge. Okay, now we're going to look at the Bayeux Tapestry, and we only have 10 minutes, so we're not going to get through with the whole thing, but we're going to have a look at it and get as far as we can, and we'll continue after the break. Okay, the first things I'm going to show you is I'm going to show you a map of England under Edward the Confessor, and then the story of the Bayeux Tapestry as it progresses and tells the story. According to the Norman version, in 1063, King Edward sent Earl Harold Godwinson to inform William that William will succeed to the throne of England. Harold started out for the coast, preceded by his pack of hounds, and then we have a picture of Harold going on board. But winds force his ships aground on land belonging to Count Guy of Ponthieu. Okay, so here we have the map of England showing actually Godwin at this time is Earl of Essex and also of Kent and of Mercia, so he's a very powerful earl in England. And here is Edward sending Harold to Normandy, and here is Harold setting out to go to Normandy to tell William. Doesn't that sound suspicious? Tell William that he's going to be the heir. And here is Harold and his men going to Bosham with their hounds, and then they're going to get in their ship and sail to Ponthieu. Now remember where Ponthieu is? It is right here in this area, right in here. Okay, and so he went to Bosham, he's blown off course, and he lands in Ponthieu. When he gets to Ponthieu, which is not in Normandy, the Count of Ponthieu takes him captive, and here's our map of Ponthieu right over here. Okay, let me go back. There is Ponthieu, Guy of Ponthieu, okay. It's the Count of Ponthieu. No, it's not in Brittany.
Flanders.
It's in Flanders, yeah. Not quite in Flanders. It's between Normandy and Flanders. Frisia. It's in the disputed territory. Frisia is where it is. Yeah. Okay, so here he is. Now, then in the next scene, the English are landing, And the Count of Ponthieu takes Harold prisoner because he's not a Norman. So he takes, and so he's going to hold him for ransom, because this is how battles are really fought in Normandy at this time and in Europe. That you don't want to kill somebody, you want to hold him for ransom and get money. Okay, informed of Harold's predicament, William sends messengers to Guy with orders to release Harold. And with their hair flying in the wind, two armored horsemen hurry to Beaurain in Ponthieu. Harold is set free, and Guy hands him over to William and his men. So here is Guy of Ponthieu riding to take Harold to William. And notice the little marginalia. We've got hunting dogs to remind us of the dogs that Harold had brought with him. Okay. And here is Guy of Ponthieu delivering Harold to Duke William. Okay, he's pointing to Harold. Here he is, you can have him, and here's Duke William. All right. Then they go to William's palace, and there are negotiations between William and Harold. Then Harold goes on an adventure with Duke William, and they go to the other side of Normandy, and they go to Mont Saint-Michel, and then they go to the city of Dole in Brittany, and they attack the city of Dole and conquer it. Norman army marches into Dole, and Duke Conan is forced to flee. Duke Conan of Brittany surrenders and hands over the keys of the city on the tip of his lance. Okay, and here is Duke William receiving Harold at his palace and taking him as a comrade in arms, and then they're going to go off on an adventure. And here they are after they've captured Dole, and here is the city of Dole, or the castle of Dole, on top of a mound, and their battle is going on, and Conan is giving the keys to the city to Duke William. All right, then they go back to William's headquarters, and William knights Harold. Touching two reliquaries, Harold then swears fealty to William. He does homage and fealty. And homage and fealty are the ceremonies by which a man becomes the vassal of a lord in the feudal system. And Harold swears, okay? Harold then goes back to England and reports to Harold on his mission to Normandy. Then, right after that, Edward dies. And we see him dying in the tapestry. His corpse is carried to St. Peter's Church after he's dead. But then there's a flashback. And we see Edward on his deathbed, where he is promising to Harold the kingdom of England. And when you read that really carefully, that story is told in the life of King Edward. And what it says is, if you read it carefully, it says that William is giving the kingdom to his wife, Edith, and that Harold is supposed to be the caretaker of Edith. And so he seems to be interpreting, or that's a Norman version too, because Edith wrote the life of King Edward. She had it written under the Normans. So that's really a Norman twist to what was happening. Anyway, on his deathbed, Harold claims that Edward gave him the kingdom. And then he goes out and he is crowned. He is voted and acclaimed king by the Witan, and the two primates of England proclaim him king, according to the English version. According to the Norman version, he is a false king. He is a breaker of his oaths. He has broken all his oaths of fealty. He has broken his solemn promise to God that he will recognize William as the conqueror, as the heir to the English throne. So he is guilty of perjury, and he must die. He's broken his oath to God. And so that's the Norman justification. Here is William coming with arms to the castle of Dol. And here is the swearing on the relics. Notice there are two stacks of relics, one for each hand, so that we can be really sure in the tapestry that he's swearing on the to God on the relics, that he is swearing homage to Duke William. Here Harold makes the sacrament. Here Harold swears fealty to Duke William. Okay, and now here is the flashback to Edward's funeral. Okay, so we've gotten just to the point where Edward has died. The next scenes in the story are going to be William, Harold seizing the throne. According to the Norman version, he seizes the throne, and then William gets his act in gear, and he gets everything ready for the invasion of England. So we'll have our break for about 15 minutes, and when we come back, we'll continue the story of William going across the Channel and conquering England. We're having a discussion about when the Vikings became Normans, and what's come up here is the issue of whether the Vikings brought women with them, and what the impact of marrying French women would have in the context of when the Normans began to speak French, when the Vikings in Normandy began to speak French. We know they began to speak French almost immediately. And we know from some of the chronicles, for example, that I think it was William Longsword who had to be sent to Caen to learn how to speak Old Norse, because he only spoke French, okay, in that case. That's one piece of evidence, but there's other evidence that further waves of settlers came to the city of Caen in western Normandy and spoke Scandinavian, and that is at least 100 years after Rollo. So both things were happening. There were Scandinavian women who also settled, but the Vikings also married French women. And they were bilingual. There were groups that were bilingual, and both languages were spoken for quite a period. So there's an age of transition that goes on. Remember, Rollo came in 911, and 1066 is only about 150 years after that. I mean, I think that the Norman conquest was instrumental in turning them into Normans. And I think it's in William the Conqueror's time that you can say they're finally not Vikings anymore. Yeah, what do you think?
But even the Christianization happens pretty rapidly. I mean, you have got Longsword that becomes very Christian. And wouldn't that also, because of the fact that there's monastic institutions already in France, that would generate a lot of French activity?
Yes, but the Vikings had pretty much wiped them out in Normandy. And remember, we were talking about the Dukes of Normandy having to refound the abandoned monasteries. They had been abandoned. And so they had to be reestablished, and the Dukes were quite prominent in doing that. But then, in the early 1000s, around the 1020s and 1030s, then you have the aristocrats emulating the dukes and also founding monasteries. So that's when it really gets into full swing. It takes at least 100 years for all of that to happen. And I would still, I mean, that's when Erlewine and the life of Erlewine is written, and it describes Normandy as still pagan. At least that particular work does, and it's one of the earliest works to be written about early Normandy. So a lot of different things are happening all at the same time, and you can't really say only one thing was operating when a number of different factors were actually operating simultaneously. So it's a complex kind of a settlement. And unfortunately, historians argue about it quite a bit.
Okay. Professor Vaughn?
Yes, question.
I've got a question that's it's along the same lines. It's talking about the origins of the Danes. And I found something that was written by Orderic Vitalis.
Mm-hmm.
Says that he calls them people of Trojan origin.
Yes.
And I also found, was that a common conception amongst the people of that time that they were descended from the Trojans?
Yes. Can any of you guess why Orderic would want to say that the Danes came from a Trojan origin? Why do you think, Press and Mike?
Well, Greek and Trojan civilization was considered very classical and very civilized, whereas, well, Scandinavia was considered very uncivilized. And if you're trying to make it in the civilized Christian European world, then you want to make yourself, give yourself as honorable in their eyes a background as you can.
It helps to legitimate.
Press your mic.
I say it would help to legitimate their claims as rulers and
antiquity. Yes, and so who else claimed the Trojans as their ancestors? Do anybody remember?
Yeah. Wasn't that William of Jumièges or something?
Jumièges, no, but other people that would inspire the Normans to claim the Trojans.
It goes back to Augustine's time, I think. The Roman emperor.
The Roman emperors, the Aeneid, Virgil in the Aeneid, claimed that there was a Trojan origin to the Romans, and that is a mythology that the Romans created for themselves. Okay, and that is exactly what the Normans are trying to do. They're trying to claim a Trojan. And I mentioned Wass before. I got all my pictures from an edition of Wass from 1850, and. He also wrote the Roman de Brit, and it's about the Trojans, the origins of the Roman de Brut, and it's the Trojan origins of the Normans, is what that story is about. It's a myth, a complete myth. Yeah.
But there's also an attempt to connect them to Noah and to Adam directly, the biblical effort.
So it's not true. I mean, it's a mythology that they create for themselves. It's a different kind of spin than the Normans are doing with the Norman conquest. Okay, let's get on with our survey of the biotapestry. Here we have the death of King Edward, and this is in the biotapestry, Edward's funeral, where he's going, they're carrying him to Westminster Abbey. And then we have a flashback. There's a flashback, as I mentioned, after that, where it shows him on his deathbed, and it shows him promising the crown to Harold, falsely. And then Harold receives the orb and the scepter at his coronation. And so the Normans then claim that Harold is not really king. He's a perjurer. He has broken his oath, his sacred oath to the church. And so therefore, he is not the legitimate king, but he is a pretender. And after the Normans conquered England, when they make up their genealogy of the kings of England, they leave Harold out, and they say he was never a legitimate king of England. They just skip from Edward the Confessor to William the Conqueror. Again, they're spin doctors. The Normans, after they conquer England, that's what they say. Okay. So we have Carold being falsely crowned king, and then God is reacting, okay? God immediately gives warning about this perjurer, and so the astrologers announce the appearance of a comet, an evil omen for Harold. A great comet goes across the sky, and we know that's really true because we can track Halley's Comet, and it was Halley's Comet that appeared in 1066. Okay, and so this was taken as a sign that there was going to be something ominous and bad happened to England. And so immediately the next scene is William ordering an invasion fleet to be built and then building the fleet and launching the vessels. Okay, and so here is the, here sits Harold, King Harold, King of the English, and here is Stigand, the Archbishop, and what the Normans are saying is that Stigand crowned him, but they're making a big deal of Stigand being there. Why?
Because he's illegal too.
So here we have the illegal Archbishop, and they label him Stigand as crowned the illegal King Harold. Okay, so this makes it clear to everyone. And here's the Witan that has elected him wrongly. Now here is Duke William, and messengers come to Duke William and they tell him that Harold has seized the throne. And then here is Harold, who is warned that William is going to come because the comet is coming. So this is warning Harold. Harold sitting on the throne as king, and there's Halley's Comet up there. Here's the palace. All right. And then messengers come to Duke William. Now they've traveled to come to Duke William, and they're telling him that perfidious Harold has seized the throne illegally. And so William then orders ships to be built, and then you can see in the next frame, here he is telling the men to go out and order ships, and of course he's sitting on a throne. And we can read the legends above. Here, Duke William orders ships to be built, okay? And here they're chopping down trees to start building the ships immediately. And now the carpenters and workmen are building the ships, and you can see they're kind of like Viking ships, aren't they? They look very Viking. Now here they're building them, the workmen are building them, and they're dragging them down to the sea and they're launching them. I'll say here they draw them to the sea. And then they carry weapons and wine on board. They also carry horses on board. Duke William boards the largest ship, and the fleet sets sail for England. Okay, they have, they're kind of skipping something there in the story that really happened. Actually, William was delayed for a time on the shore at Pevensey because the winds were, not at Pevensey, but at Valery-sur-Somme. And he was delayed for about a month with contrary winds. This was in October. No, this was in September. Contrary winds. And then suddenly, miraculously, the wind shifted, and then he was able to sail across. But interestingly, the winds did not shift until another invader, Harald Hardrada, had invaded in the north through York. And it was just when William heard that Harald had to force march his men up to the north to meet the invaders in the north that suddenly William said, well, now we can go. So there's been some speculation that there were spies in England who could then tell him that Harold had been invaded by another claimant to the throne. Yeah.
But also a month of contrary winds wouldn't fit in with their idea that God was ordaining them to go punish the perjurer. If the winds were against him for a month, it doesn't look like God is on their side, so editing that out would serve a spin purpose.
Oh, that's a good idea. Yeah, they did edit that out. But in the written stories, it tells about them being delayed. But the interpretation in the written stories was that God delayed them until the Anglo-Saxons would be, you know, weakened by the Battle of Stamford Bridge. So, yeah, comment. Could you press your mic? Oh, you? No, you didn't have a question? Oh, okay. But that part was left out. But quite an interesting little sidelight here that I'll mention about the building of the ships and the number of ships and the number of men. There have been a lot of efforts to try and figure out how many men were sent across the channel. And, of course, they took their horses and they had to camp for a whole month waiting for the winds to change. And Bernie Bacharach wrote a really interesting article about what it would take to supply the men with water and wine and food for the horses and food for the men, and how could you feed them, all those men camped there waiting to sail across the sea, not to mention the waste materials of the horses that you had to get rid of in addition to feeding those horses. And so as these people have studied the logistics of how to feed that army and where to put that army, the army has shrunk smaller and smaller. And so our estimate of the army was quite small. There have also been estimates of the army, fleet of ships and how many ships they had. Clearly, they already had a lot of ships built, merchant ships that they could commandeer. And there's a ship list where many of the most prominent men in Normandy actually gave ships that were already built. Because if they were going to build a huge fleet, big enough to take the huge army that the chroniclers report, they would have had to chop down all the trees in Normandy to build that fleet. So the number crunchers have made it smaller and smaller, that it was quite a small army that went across. Oh, something like 3,000. I mean, really small. Yeah.
There is the precedent of, in 865, there was this huge Danish army that had perhaps 300 ships.
Mm-hmm.
So there was this history of building a lot of ships and bringing across horses.
Yeah, the Vikings had done that, but they didn't build them all at one time. I mean, they had a lot of ships already. And so my guess is the Normans already had a lot of ships. And more, there's been more research done into that, and they're finding that there was a lot of trade across the channel and in the North Sea, and a lot of merchants along that northern coast of Normandy. So probably they didn't build all the ships. But then we've got this propaganda here in the tapestry that says, of course, William heroically built all the ships. Yeah.
I would believe a larger army because the chroniclers may have forgotten the fact that the ships made more than one trip. They would sail over and drop off a load, go back and pick up another load.
We don't have any evidence of that. None of them report that they went back and forth with men. And they didn't really bring that many supplies with them, because then in the tapestry, as you see them landing in England, they start living off the land. They steal all the animals for their food, and they steal the plants. They ravage the towns around England to get supplies to feed them. So they didn't bring that much with them.
As I say, whatever they probably took with them, they probably used up waiting for the winds to change, if not, in addition to probably ransacking the countryside, too.
Yeah, well, I'm sure they took some, but probably not very much, because the tapestry shows them ransacking the countryside and burning down the houses of peasants and taking the animals. Yeah.
Is there any possibility, though, of having support from within England due to the fact, well, you've got a Norman queen in England, you know, you've got Emma, and she probably would have brought at least a chunk of people with her when she came. She wouldn't have come alone.
The only Normans in England at that time were in Hereford, and that's not very close to the shore of Pevensey. There's no evidence of Englishmen cooperating with the Normans. Yeah.
There would also be the concern of not having too large an army built on this side, because what if they start to make trouble within the domain of the Normans?
Yeah. Well, as I said, you know, as it's gone through, and if you want to know more about the Battle of Hastings, this book by Stephen Murillo is probably the latest work on it, Warfare Under the Anglo-Norman Kings, 1066 to 1135. This book, Stephen Murillo, it was a little bit of a disappointment to me because I was hoping Stephen would deal with social issues of how the army integrated into the government and the social planning. But instead, it's all about battles. So if you want to know about battles and weapons and battle tactics, this is the book for you. And the Norman, the Battle of Hastings is the main one. Yes, yes, that's the History Channel style of things, but there's a lot more to history than just battles and warfare.
Yeah. On one of the anniversaries of the Battle of Hastings, within the past few years, I actually saw this on a list I used to be on, they had a huge gathering in England of reenactors and reenacted what they knew of the Battle of Hastings.
Yes, that's been going on for a long time. Actually, R. Allen Brown, who was a very famous organizer and a very famous historian, who loved the Normans, adored the Normans, and he founded a conference that was held at Battle Abbey for many, many years, and published the results in Proceeds of the Battle Abbey Conference. It's now called Anglo-Norman Studies is the journal, and they're about 30, it's been going about 30 years. And he loved the Normans, and every year we'd go to battle, and he would bring his horses and his armor and his trapping, and he'd gallop up the hill, emulating the Normans attacking. And so if you go and look at those, at some of those journals, they're actually bound books, one for each year, and you can see R. Allen Brown galloping up the hill and his horses. And so that's done a lot, yeah.
Kind of off topic, but I have a friend who does the recreation as well, and this was in San Diego, and when he went over to England, he took his chainmail shirt with him that he fights in and took it to all of the famous battle sites and placed them on all of the famous battlegrounds, and his favorite was Hastings. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, the Battle of Hastings was quite an unusual battle. Well, let's look at how they get there, and then we'll talk about the battle, because it is an important battle. Okay, so the fleet sails for England, they land at Pevensey, the men disembark their horses, and then they have a great feast. And so here they are, here are the great barrels of wine, see, huge barrels of wine, and here they are taking their chain link mail and their axes, and they've got sacks of grain or food, and then here is a carrier that they have the helmets and the javelins, so they're bringing all their weapons on board.
Where did they disembark?
Pevensey, which is on the south coast of England, and I should have a map. And here is William the Conqueror. This is his ship. How do I know that's his ship? Can you tell?
It's got the cross on
the
top.
It's got a cross on the top, yeah. So that's William's. That's the papal banner. Okay, the Normans claim that Pope Alexander II gave William the papal banner, which meant he had the right to conquer the English, that God was on his side, and God had judged Harold a perjurer who broke his sacred oath, and William was rightfully King of England. So this is the papal banner that he's carrying as he goes to conquer England. Here's the watchman with his horn, and here are the other ships sailing along. Notice they line their shields up just like the Vikings do on the side. Yeah, and here they are, they're dragging their ships up to the shore, they're leading their horses off the ship, and now they mount their horses and they gallop away in Pevensey. Sorry, I don't have the ransacking scenes of ransacking the villages. They ransack the villages, and then the servants bring in roasted meat and fowl, and William is at a banquet held in his honor, surrounded by his barons and Bishop Odo. And then they build a fortified camp, and a watchman comes to warn William of Harold's movements. A house is burned down. William gets ready to meet Harold, and the Normans advance in battle array. And as he advances, William is told that the Saxon army is close at hand. And so here is the great feast. Okay, here are these little birds being roasted on sticks. Here are the cooks that are cooking everything. There's a Viking drinking horn. And then what does this make you think of? Here is Watto serving the meal. What does this make you think of? The round table makes you... It makes me think of the Last Supper, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. It makes me think of the Last Supper. And who's in the center? It's William. So that's kind of interesting. Okay. But also the round table. I mean, it could make you think of that, too. Yeah.
In reference to the drinking horn, it looks more like it's being used as an instrument rather than to drink from, because the wide end is upward.
Oh, you're right. Upward. You're right. Good point. Yeah, I think he's blowing that horn. It's an oliphant. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, and here they are. They build a castle, okay? And it's a Mott and Bailey castle. Remember we saw our castles last time? And so they build this artificial mound, and then they're digging a moat around it, and then they build the castle on top. This is the castle at Hastings that they're building. That's still there to this day. And here, William hears about Harold. He hears that Harold is near, and a messenger comes and tells him Harold's coming. A watchman runs to warn Harold then of the Norman army's approach. William makes a speech to his soldiers, and when we find it in some of the Norman sources, it's a very long speech. He never could have made a speech that long. He exhorts them to fight heroically, and then they advance against the English army. And the Saxons are foot soldiers. The Normans attack the shield wall. Okay, what happens is we know for sure that the English claim the high ground, the best spot to defend their land, at the top of the hill in Hastings. And the Normans then had to charge up that hill. And the Saxons dismounted and they made a shield wall. What they did was stand as a group and put shields all the way around them and on top of them. And so they were in a very defensive position. So the Normans attack them. And then they fight fiercely, and Lewin and Geard, Harold's brothers, are killed in the melee as they first go. So here are the Normans. Here is William, and I'm sorry he's a little bit cut off, but he's exhorting his men. Duke William, aloquitur suis militis, militibus. So he's exhorting his men and making a speech. Okay, and here they are now. They're running into battle, and here are the foot soldiers preceding them, shooting arrows at the Saxons. And some of the foot soldiers have chain-link mail, and some of them don't. But the cavalry goes in afterwards, and now they attack the shield wall. Okay, the Saxons are at the top of the hill, and they've got a shield wall around them, and the Normans attack them, but they have to gallop uphill to get here. And here in the margins, we have all the dead bodies that are being...
Are those like the vultures up top?
Or? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Their comments on the action. And here are Alwyn and Geard, the brothers of Harold, are killed in this scene. These are Saxons fighting on foot. They have round shields. The Normans have kite-shaped shields. Okay, the Normans fight on horseback. And these are Norman shields here. Here's a decapitated guy. Okay. And then the king is killed. The battle is raging. And let me just mention a couple of things about the Battle of Hastings. It's a very, very unusual battle. In most of the medieval battles that are fought, they last 20 minutes to an hour. 20 minutes is a pretty common battle. Battles themselves are not very common in medieval warfare at this time. And afterwards in the 12th century as well, because the main battle tactic was to invest a city, to blockade it and starve it out. and the goal was not to kill people, but the goal was to take them for ransom, and then you could keep their horse and their armor, which were worth a king's ransom anyway, and then hold them for ransom and get money from their family. So there really was very little killing in a lot of these battles because the aim was to take people captive. So the Battle of Hastings was an extraordinary battle, a very, very different battle. It lasted for 9 hours from approximately sunup to sunset. 9 hours. It's one of the longest battles in all history, one of the greatest battles in history. And modern historians have come to the conclusion that the two sets of armies, the two armies were evenly matched, that it was touch and go the whole way, that neither one of them had the advantage. It wasn't the cavalry of the Normans that was superior. The shield wall of the Anglo-Saxons was just as good a defensive strategy, and the battle, you know, remained equal all day long. And then something extraordinary happened. Duke William was knocked off his horse at least once, but then a rumor spread through the whole Norman army that Duke William had been killed. And so he got another horse. I think it was Eustace of Boulogne, gave him another horse. He got up on it, and he threw his helmet back, and he said, "I'm here, I'm alive." And the Normans had, before he did that, the Normans had started to run away and advance. And at that point, the Anglo-Saxons broke the shield wall and started to chase after the Normans. And when William threw back his helmet and said, "I'm alive, I'm here, turn around and come back." And they did. They wheeled their horses and came back. And before the shield wall could get back in place again, and that was the turning point that meant the Normans won the battle. And so one of the greatest debates among military historians is whether this was a planned, feigned flight or whether it was an accident, whether he meant to do that. And so the only way you can tell is to, I mean, the way the story is told in the Norman sources, it was an accident. I mean, truly, William was unhorsed. He had to get back on his horse. The Normans fled because they thought he was dead. And then he rallied them back, and they turned around, and they won the battle. Now, there is evidence of Normans in Italy actually using real feigned flights and using trickery of that kind. So, I mean, your guess is as good as mine. It's a 50-50 chance. Who knows if they planned it or not? We don't know from the evidence that we read. It's only a guess whether this was a clever tactic or whether it was an accident. They portray it as an accident. Why do you think they would portray it as an accident?
I'm not really too sure on that, because if you know, as you said, they tend to very much enjoy winning by cleverness, and so
the Vikings did. Yeah,
but could that have still lasted through them? Because as you said, the Normans in Italy would use this tactic.
It looks like the Normans in Italy would use that tactic, but there is a clear reason why they might have portrayed it in the biotapestry as an accident. Why do you think?
Because that shows that God intervened to help them.
Exactly. Because the propaganda, the spin there is that it wasn't a trick, it wasn't an accident, it was God intervening to make it come out the way God wanted it to come out. Yeah.
So reversals of this sort are good. I mean, as the 1 month delay could also be used that way.
Yes, exactly. The same way, the same symbolism that they could use the 1 month delay for is that God knows best, and God has plans for them, and He's guiding. It's His guiding hand which is designating William as the winner and William as the victor and king of England. So the propaganda there is that God is choosing William. And we see it through a process of choosing William. Yeah.
So this is all the more reason that this reports that we get of the battle should be looked at carefully, because there is propaganda value in this.
Exactly.
Portrayal.
Exactly. But the Normans believed their propaganda. They believed it. And so is it propaganda if they believed it? That's an interesting question too.
It's very confusing because up at the top of the list you have 49, here the king is killed.
Yes.
And then you have down at 54, Harold dies after being shot in the eye with an arrow.
Oh, I'm glad you noticed that. There are actually two scenes of the king being killed. He's shown being killed. Let's see if I hope I have both of those pictures, but I don't think I have him being shot in the eye with an arrow. That might have been inferior editing and repairing of the tapestry, because there's a legend that the only way you can kill a real king is to shoot him in the eye with an arrow. That's a legend. And so it may have been an improper reconstruction of the tapestry after the fact. But and so if that's the case, anyway, let's take a look at it. Here is the battle going on in full force, and it went for 9 hours, so a lot of the tapestry has to do with battle. But this is a really interesting one. Here is Bishop Odo. Here Odo Episcopus fights holding a club, okay? Because according to the Reformed Church, churchmen are not allowed to shed blood with a sword. But you can use a club. So he's bashing them with a club so that he doesn't violate the church laws and shed blood with the sword. So how Viking is that? Yeah, come in.
Would this be before or after you see the sort of monastic military orders that have happened through Europe?
Oh, this is before. The military orders, that's an excellent question. The military orders start maybe around 1100, which would be the 12th century. They really start after the First Crusade, and Jerusalem falls in 1099. So this would be after that. That's an interesting question. When I do my Crusades course, I speak of the Battle of Hastings and the conquest of England. I speak of it as a kind of prelude to crusade, that this is a kind of crusade. God is on their side and the Pope is sending them. Yeah, come in.
But the interesting thing that they're Christians fighting Christians, so legitimacy is very important, and it seems like the whole picture has to be constructed very carefully.
Yes, it does. And you have these religious people to please, mostly Lanfranc, because he is guiding the propaganda here as well. He's telling them what God is doing for them and how to interpret it. The churchmen actually tell them how to interpret it. So there's that religious dimension. So anyway, here's...
Have churchmen always been telling us how to interpret things?
Well, that's part of the interpretation of history. Remember that history is largely interpretation. You have a set of facts, and how you interpret them is something altogether different.
Professor Vaughn?
A biblical precedent of God supporting, yes, Joshua and the Battle of Jericho. I mean, there are all kinds of biblical precedents of God acting in history, and so they're picking that up. So here is Odo, and here
Professor?
Is the feigned flight. Yes, question.
Yes, you said something about the reconstruction of the tapestry.
Uh-huh.
Did you mean that people later on in history actually re-sewed certain parts of it?
Yes, I'm glad you're asking that question, because remember in the French Revolution they wrapped it around a cannon and they broke some of the threads?
Yes.
And so people went back very carefully and they examined it under a microscope or magnifying glass to see where the actual little holes were where the thread went. And so it has been reconstructed, and in fact that's one of the chapters in Wolfgang Grape's book about the reconstruction. And one of the scenes he questions is the arrow in the eye of Harold. So it has been reconstructed, and you have to take that into account when you're examining it as well.
How much has it has been reconstructed?
Not very much. Oh, but because every single scene is so crucial and important, you know, even a little reconstruction makes you really think about it.
How did the linen last for over 1,000 years?
Well, it's good quality linen. Yeah.
I'm kind of a textile freak. The linen also that they made back then and throughout the Middle Ages had a much higher count and was much finer quality than the ones today. Back today, the highest count you can probably find is like 60 or 120 or something, and that's what they put on the servants back then. They had much finer, much more even weave linen that was done by hand than they can do today on machine.
Yeah, so it was very, very good quality linen. And in fact, it's in quite good shape as you look at it today. I mean, it's...
And it wasn't washed
a lot. It's been cared for really carefully, yeah.
Washing machines would...
Washing machines would... Right. Well, I don't think they washed it very much anyway.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. That's probably why.
But they have it very, very carefully preserved. Now, today, when you go to Bayou, they've got it in this room, and they've got this sort of lighted panel, and they have it spread out on this lighted panel, and it's backlit, so you can see it very clearly as you look at it. I really don't like that method of displaying it. I liked it when it was on the wall 20 or 30 years ago, but now it's in this backlit thing. Pardon? As Odo intended it, yes, as the Normans would have seen it themselves. That's the way I like to see it. Well, here, let's go back to our picture here, and we see the feigned flight question mark. But here is Duke William throwing back his helmet and saying, "Here I am, here I am." And you know, I suddenly... I noticed that he had a club too. And so this raises some very, very interesting questions about what they're trying to portray there. And I don't recall Wolfgang Grape discussing that point, that William has a club. But doesn't it imply that he has some kind of a priestly quality to him if he is also wielding a club just like Odo? You want to press your mic?
The king, as I would imagine, as divine ruler or having a divine right to rule, I'd imagine that's how they would tie that in.
Exactly. So they're giving him a priestly quality even before he conquers England and kills the old king. Yeah.
I would think about Samson and the Judges, the Book of Judges.
Oh,
I mean, that's an example.
Remind me of that story. Okay.
I mean, the use of this bone thing.
Oh, okay, yeah, comment.
I think it actually supports the idea that his feigned flight was, that he really did, was dismounted, and what he did was he simply grabbed the first, when he got back on, he simply grabbed the first weapon he could get his hold of.
Well, that's a matter of interpretation. I mean, we don't know. What we've got is a picture. None of the written accounts tell us that he had a club.
This book says that during the battle, his authority is displayed by carrying a kind of a club or a mace, so possibly that's what that is.
Okay, which book are you looking at? Bates. That's not Bates.
No, that's William the Conqueror, it's page 93.
Oh, that's Bates. Okay, good. Bates has made a point of that. That's good. So that this does imply his authority through carrying a club. Yeah, but Bates doesn't go quite as far as we have here in saying maybe it's religious. Yeah.
Well, you could also take it as like the kingly scepter is, you know, he could take that into battle, or a kingly mace. It looks more like, you know, a scepter or a ruling regalia or what have you that he could take onto the battlefield.
Quite possibly.
Yeah, well, that's stretching it a little far, because how can you fight with a scepter?
But I'm saying it would look much closer.
Yeah, but it looks like a club to me. I mean, it looks like a club. It doesn't look like a mace. It looks like a club.
But in other depictions of William in the tapestry, is he wielding a club or is he wielding a sword? Because there's going to be more than one of the hero.
Mm-hmm. In other depictions, it's not clear. Maybe we can go back to some. Let's see.
At the top, it says that he charged forward wielding his sword, cutting down several of the enemy. So I suspect they use various... they show him carrying various things.
Well, we did have, they do. And here is, okay, the brothers being killed. And here is, okay.
There's complex symbology involved here.
Yeah. Not finding another William. Here's William. Allocuting. Okay. We can only see half of him, so we can't see what he's carrying. Well, we'll have to look in the big one. Let's see. So here is Alfwen and Gerd, the brothers being killed, and then Odo, the feigned flight, and then here is Harald the king is killed. That's what it says. Harald Rex Interfectus Est. All right. And here is, I think this is the one that shows him with the arrow in the eye, right here. But then it says he's killed. So it may be two scenes. Here's the arrow in the eye, but he's got a kite-shaped shield. And here he is being killed, because this refers to this. Here is a Norman killing Harald the king. And then we have these really sad bodies all along the bottom. This is not imperfections in the tapestry. This book I took this out of was published in 1850, and there's a Victorian sensibility. Those are the pornographic ones, yes, and they have cut them out of the picture. Yeah.
But this does raise question about the historical value of the tapestry in terms of reconstructing the actual battle scenes, because if it has symbolic value and religious meaning, then we have to account for that in terms of reconstruction, because the actual battles, if you're interested in reconstructing and if you're interested in military history, then it does reduce the value of the document.
Yes,
you
it
would
reduces the value. If there's a lot of symbolism, then we don't know how far the truth is being twisted. You're absolutely right. And then the end of it is missing. The end of the biotapestry is missing after Harald is killed. But probably the grand climax of the tapestry was the coronation of King William. And so this is William's coin, and it shows him both as a warrior with a shield, and here he has a spear or a javelin, and here he is as the king seated on his throne, and this is how he portrayed himself on his crown, carrying the orb of the earth as he's ruling. This is the scepter and a sword in one hand. So he showed himself as a conqueror. I mean, here is a symbolism on his own coin. And so let's kind of read what he's saying on that coin. The seal of... I can't read that.
It's a very eccentric lettering, isn't it?
Yeah. It is. Whence, and then I don't know what that is. Angles regem. Okay, so king of the English. I can't make that out. And here he's named William. Here's his name, William. It's hard to read it upside down. This says Normanorum. Okay, of the Normans. William of the Normans. Okay. Yeah, Patronum. There are some abbreviations in there that I can't figure out right now. Okay, and this is Battle Abbey, that he built on the site of
Professor
the Battle
Bond?
Of Hastings. Yes, question.
Just real quick, there's a live mic somewhere in your room. I think it could be near a door, which is creating some background noise or something. I don't know, because I've been hearing it the whole time. There's I don't know.
I don't know what the live mic would
If someone like in the tech crew or something could try and locate that and.
Yeah, did you hear that, Don?
I don't know.
Yeah, they heard that. They're going to see if they can find it. I don't think anyone here is pressing the mic that's making a noise. Maybe just some interference.
Actually, I'm afraid
the problems are gone now.
The what?
Problems
are gone. Oh, the problems are gone now. Okay, good. Okay. The hand of God. Okay, here is Battle Abbey. This is the seal of Battle Abbey. It says seal, sigillum, conventum, which is the convent or the abbey of St. Martin's of Battle, Bello de Battle, Battle Abbey, that he built on the site of the Battle of Hastings. Okay. Now, here we are on the English version, and we're almost out of time, so I don't know if we... Would we want to have maybe some discussion of the Norman version at this point, and then we'll wait for the English version until next week? Because we only have about 30 minutes. Perhaps we can maybe read in... read some of the Norman versions. I think that would be a really good idea. If we look at, we might make a couple of points about what the Norman said. Here is Norman and other continental narratives. Okay. I'm looking on page 112, Norman and Other Continental Narratives. And this is such a wonderful book that she goes through and tells the whole story from the Norman point of view, and then she tells the story from the English point of view, and then she gives you the primary sources so that you can read the actual story of it. Okay, here is the Discovery and Miracles of St. Wulfran. And it was written in 1053 to 1054, which is a foretelling of the conquest of England. Okay. Edward was the elder of the two. These are the sons of Emma and Ethelred. Though still no more than a soft and callow youth, with the blessing of his father and the approval of the people of the realm, he was anointed and consecrated as king. Not long afterwards, okay, here in the Miracles of St. Wulfram, which was found in St. Wandrill in an abbey in Normandy, what they're saying is that Edward was consecrated king before his father died. Okay, now so this is the Norman justification of supporting Edward as king. And then Canute comes to the throne. Canute marries Emma. He had by her a son, Harthacnut Canute, and also a daughter, Gunhilda. When Grummith had reached a marriageable age, or Gunhilda, she married Henry III, Emperor of the Romans and Saxons, so that would have been the German emperor. As befits a royal daughter in great secular splendor, she only produced a daughter for him because she herself died shortly afterwards. When this daughter came of age, she spurned carnal union in favor of the heavenly consort. That means she became a nun. And taking up her sacred veil, she dedicated her virginity to God, the King of all. A long time passed under three kings, namely Canute, whom I spoke about earlier, his son Harold Harefoot, whom his concubine Alfgifu bore, but also Hardicanute, his legitimate son. Okay, here is propaganda. They're declaring Alfgifu, even though she was his real Danish wife, they're declaring her a concubine because he married he married Emma as a in a Christian marriage. But according to the church, you can't divorce your wife, so they just declared Al-Ghafu a concubine. And this is the kind of propaganda we're looking at. Okay, and they're calling Hardicanute his legitimate son. And so this is the story according to the miracles of St. Wolfram. Now, here is William of Jumièges' text, The Deeds of the Dukes of the Normans. Edward, King of the English, by the will of God, having no heir, had in the past sent Robert, Archbishop of Canterbury, to the Duke William to appoint him heir to the kingdom given to him by God. All right, that glosses over completely the fact that Robert of Jumièges was sent into exile. But he also, at a later date, sent him to Harold, the greatest of all earls in his realm, in wealth, honor, and power, that he should swear fealty to the Duke concerning his crown, and according to the Christian custom, pledge it with oaths. Okay, here the story goes that Edward sent Harold to make an oath to William. All right. Then, after Harold had sworn fealty to him about the kingdom, with many oaths he promised that he would give him his daughter, Adeliza, with half the kingdom of England. Later he sent him back to the king with many gifts, but kept as hostage his handsome brother, Wulfnoth. At length, having completed his fortunate life, Edward departed from this world in the year of the Lord, 1065, whereupon Harold immediately seized Edward's kingdom, thus perjuring the fealty he had sworn to the Duke. Okay, so he is a perjurer, he is a liar, he is an oath breaker, and so this is the Norman justification. There's a little information about the army here. Okay, let's take up the story a little bit further. In Book 7, Chapter 8, 14, when the Duke, this is Duke William, who by right should have been crowned with the royal diadem, observed how Harold daily grew in strength, he had a fleet of up to 3,000 ships hastily put together and anchored at St. Valery in Ponthieu, full of vigorous horses and very strong men armed with hauberks and helmets. Thence, with favorable wind and sails billowing aloft, he crossed the sea and landed at Pevensey, where at once he built a strongly entrenched fortification. He entrusted it to his warriors and speedily went to Hastings, where he quickly raised another one. Harold, hastening to take him by surprise, gathered innumerable English forces and, riding through the night, arrived at the battlefield at dawn. Okay, that's slightly different than the Bayeux Tapestry is telling the story. So what we've got is about 10 different versions of this battle, and so it's really hard to put it together. Yeah.
In regards to the historians trying to figure out how many men may have fought in this battle, mm-hmm. has there been much archaeology done on the battlefield of Hastings to see what may lie in terms of bones underneath the soil?
Not bones underneath the soil, but there's been a lot done with like the lay of the land and the defenses that were built. There were ditches that were built as defenses, and there's been a lot of study of that. But not bones or anything of that. Yeah, question.
This text seems to suggest then that Harold is England is a fief of William.
No, it's suggesting that Harold is recognizing William as the rightful king.
By swearing
fealty to him, because Harold is the strongest, most powerful man in all of England. And everybody knows that already.
But his building of his army is then going back on his...
Yes, it's going back on his sacred oath to God. I mean, when you swear on stacks of relics, you're swearing to God, not to William. So, yeah, comment.
It's difficult to do a lot of archaeological exploration there at the battle because around the abbey itself being consecrated ground, they used a lot of it as a cemetery.
Oh, that's true.
They will show you, of course, where Harold and his brothers are buried. There, they even mm-hmm. put up markers for them. But it's difficult then to dig as a result.
Well, you know, they wouldn't have just left them on the battlefield. They would have found the dead, and they would have taken them and given them a Christian burial, and the families would have reclaimed them, and you know, they wouldn't just lie where they had fallen. And so it's but you can excavate a battlefield. And certainly the battlefield at Hastings, I mean, you can go there and the hill is still there. You can see where the hill is and it's all marked and the abbey is on top of it. Yeah.
As I say, you'd probably find something like shield bosses or rivets.
No, they'd all be in museums.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's probably what they would have found. You're not going to find anything now. It's been done to death.
Yeah, but. That, you're right. I mean, they're all in museums now, so we wouldn't find anything on the battlefield today. We might say a bit about William's army, and this is an important thing to look about William's army. I keep saying the Normans did this and the Normans did that, and William, as Duke of the Normans, led everybody. But the army was very cosmopolitan in nature. One of his right-hand men was Eustace, Count of Boulogne, and so there were a lot of Flemish in the army as well. There were lots and lots of people from Brittany in the army, because at this time, and also men from Maine, because at this time William had already conquered Maine and Brittany. Remember, we made the point that he had conquered Maine and Brittany. So it was quite an international force, and there were even some Frenchmen there. And so after William conquered England, when he actually controlled England, and I'll mention this when we try to reconstruct the government that he created, he addressed all of his charters to all my men, English and French. So he started calling his men the French. And the reason he's doing this is because he has an international force, and after the conquest of England, he then he didn't win it all in one battle. I mean, the Battle of Hastings was decisive because the king was killed. The very next thing he did was make his way to London, and by Christmas he was crowned king in London and consecrated. He was crowned by, not surprisingly, the Archbishop of York. Why? Because Stigand was still Archbishop of Canterbury, and he was an illegal archbishop. So he made the point of being crowned by the Archbishop of York in the coronation. Yeah.
York is strongly Scandinavian?
Yes, York was strongly Scandinavian, but by this time, the archbishops were rivaling each other. For power, there are two archbishops in England, the Archbishop of Canterbury and the Archbishop of York. And the Archbishop of Canterbury was the first bishop of England when it was converted by the missionaries from Rome in the time of St. Gregory the Great. And Gregory wrote a letter, which is preserved in Bede, and the letter gives instructions saying that first there should be an Archbishop of Canterbury, later Canterbury should be moved to London, and the Archbishop of London should be supreme, sharing power 50-50 with the Archbishop of York, and both of them should have 12 sub-bishops underneath them. 12 bishops underneath them, but they should rule England equally. Well, historically, that never happened. There never was an Archbishop of London, and so the Archbishop of Canterbury remained in place. And what happened was that Gregory had envisioned that the Archbishop of York would convert all of Scotland and take it all under his power, but that never happened because Scotland stayed separate. And so, in reality, the Archbishop of Canterbury was much more powerful than the Archbishop of York, but in theory, as expressed in Bede, they were equals. And so you had this rivalry going on between them. And what Gregory said was that if there are two archbishops and the Archbishop of Canterbury dies, then the new archbishop should be consecrated by the Archbishop of York, and likewise, if York dies, Canterbury should consecrate. Well, since the church believed that God acts in history And even though Gregory left those instructions, the historical development was the Archbishop of Canterbury was the strongest. And remember, we had the reforms during the reign of Æthelstan, where St. Dunstan came into England and strengthened the church, the monasteries. And so historically, Canterbury was the strongest, and so there was a faction within the church led by Canterbury that wanted Canterbury, that said that God rightly wanted Canterbury to be the strongest. The Archbishop of York, arguing from the sacred law of the history of Bede and the papal letter, argued that they should be equal. So there was this rivalry between York and Canterbury, and so York jumped on this chance to crown the King of England to show his equality to Canterbury. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, Alcuin was from Northumbria.
So they have the service to Christendom that belongs to the North also.
But there are two branches to the church. Oh, you forgot the mic. Yeah, okay. There are two branches to the medieval church. There are what are called the secular clergy and the regular clergy. The secular clergy are the bishops and the priests and the archbishops, and they minister to secular people. The regular clergy are under a rule. Regular means rule, and they are the monasteries. And so Alcuin was a monk, and so he would have come from the prestigious area of the north, and there were prestigious monasteries in the north. But that didn't necessarily transfer to the secular rulers, which would have been the Archbishop of York. So, I mean, there are all these little ins and outs of the whole thing. So I really wanted to make the point, though, that this army was quite international, and there were people from all over, because after the conquest, then, William was going to have a whole lot of trouble with those Bretons and Manso and French and Flemish. Menso, the people from Maine are the Menso, yeah. Uh-huh. So. Okay, so 3,000 ships is the number that is routinely said. Okay. Okay, and here is some Norman propaganda. And this is about Harold, who then went north and fought the Battle of Stamford Bridge, and then went back to, he killed his brother Tostig in that battle, and so then he went back to face the Norman invasion with the news of the Norman invasion, when Harold was told that a more aggressive army enemy presented himself in another part of the country, he prepared himself again for yet another combat, for he was a brave and valiant man, very handsome, pleasant in speech, and a good friend to all. However, his mother and other loyal friends tried to dissuade him from war, and his brother, Earl Gurr, said to him, "My dearest brother and lord, you should let your prowess temper your valor. You have only just returned worn out after the war against the Norwegians, and now you are hastening to fight once more against the Normans. But rest, I beg you. You ought to contemplate carefully what you pledge by oath to the Duke of the Normans. Take care that you do not commit perjury and by this crime destroy yourself as well as the flower of our people and bring everlasting shame to our posterity." Clearly, this is a totally made-up speech in the Norman propaganda that his own brother warns him. And so the irony is Gurr, the brother, is going to be killed in the bio tapestry. So this, I mean, there's irony here in building this story. And when that happened, well, here, let me continue Gurr's speech. "I have sworn no oath and owe nothing to Duke William. Therefore, I am ready to join battle boldly with him for my native soil. But you, my brother, should wait in peace wherever you like for the outcome of this war, lest the liberty of the English should perish through your ruin." After these words, Harold flew into a violent rage. He despised the counsel that seemed wise to his friends, taunted his brother, who loyally gave him advice, and when his mother anxiously tried to hold him back, he insolently kicked her. Here's this portrait of violent rage in Harold, and he's such a bad guy, he kicks his mother. So this is Norman propaganda, clearly. Then the Duke goes into battle to stand to arms from dusk to dawn. Okay, so the Duke is given prescient knowledge that the battle is going to last from dusk to dawn. In hindsight, they credit him with knowing how long it'll last, and he arranges his legions in three divisions and so on. Battle was joined at the third hour, and the slaughter on both sides continued until the late evening. Harold himself was slain, pierced with mortal wounds during the first assault. When the English learned that their king had met his death, they greatly feared for their own lives and turned about at nightfall and sought refuge in flight. When thus the Normans saw the English fleeing, they pursued them obstinately through the night till Sunday to their own harm. For high grass concealed an ancient rampart, and as the Normans, fully armed on their horses, rode up against it, they fell one on top of the other, thus crushing each other to death. It is said that almost 15,000 men perished there. Thus, on 14 October, Almighty God punished the countless sinners on both sides in diverse ways. For while madness was raging among the Normans, God slaughtered many thousands of Englishmen who long before had unjustly murdered the innocent Alfred. Okay, the innocent Alfred had been murdered. And on the previous Saturday, without mercy, had slain King Harold, Earl Tostig, and many others. Okay, referring to Harold Hardrada and Tostig, the brother of Harold Godwinson, who had been killed. So, I mean, they're just piling up all the black marks they can against Harold in every way possible. Yeah.
It's surprising that so early in some of these early sources they recognize the importance of this battle, which we can see in hindsight the importance, but it's interesting that the observers of that time give it that kind of turning point importance.
Yeah, because it was such an unusual battle. I mean, it was very striking and very unusual, and they saw the hand of God operating in it. And but actually, William did not conquer England in one battle. It just appeared that way, and one reason they claimed he did is because King Harold died. And then he was crowned king, and then they regarded him as being a controller of England. But it wasn't really true, because for the next 2 years he had to go, especially in the north of England, and it's called the Harrying of the North. It's part of the legend that he conquered England in one battle in one day. But and then the Harrying of the North is regarded in the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle as the cruelty of William. But in reality, the North is where all of his opponents were, and it was rebelling. And so it was really the continuation of the conquest that he was going through. But because of the mythology of him having conquered England in one battle, they have to interpret it differently.
But yeah. The fact is, the mythology exists, and connecting with Alfred is also very interesting, that there is a continuity of good kings.
Yes. Oh, that's a whole different thing about the good kings and the bad kings. Yes, and that's a really interesting point, but we don't have time to go into all of that. Good kings seem to alternate with bad kings in Bede. And then you find it in some of the English sources that good kings and bad kings alternate. But in the English sources, they loved King Harold. They didn't see anything wrong with him. I mean, he's so maligned in these Norman sources. Here is the description of the coronation, okay. The valiant Duke returned from the slaughter of his enemy to the battlefield at midnight. Then he looted the enemy and buried the corpses of his own dear men. He set out for London. It is said that in this battle many thousands of English perished, this being God's retribution for their unjust murder of Alfred, King Edward's brother. The very fortunate war leader, William, supported by excellent counsel, came to a first stop at Wallingford, where, turning away from the city, he crossed the river and ordered his troops to pitch camp there. From there, he moved on to London, where upon entering the city, some scouts sent ahead found many rebels determined to offer every possible resistance. Fighting followed immediately, and thus London was plunged into mourning for the loss of her sons and citizens. The Londoners finally surrendered the city, and now the conquest was complete. Despite the many manifold perils, our most illustrious Duke, to whom our written tribute cannot do enough justice, on Christmas Day was elected king by all the magnates, both of the Normans and the English, anointed with holy chrism by the bishops of the realm, and crowned with the royal diadem in the year of our Lord, 1066. Now, you were asking at the break, what are the criteria for choosing a king, and how is a king chosen? This outlines how the English choose their king. By tradition, the king is chosen, selected by inheritance, so that by designation, the old king can designate who will be the next king. He can inherit the throne, and William the Conqueror is regarded as inheriting the throne from his cousin. And he is then elected by the clergy and people, so that the magnates acclaimed him and the clergy acclaimed him. And then the acclamation by the clergy is summed up by the anointing with holy oil. And once the king is anointed with holy oil, that's the same process, the same ceremony a priest goes through, and he becomes a priestly king. And that means he can never be deposed, because once he's had the royal chrism, the holy oil, he's just like a bishop, and he is in his office for life. Yeah.
I see in this last bit either a connection to the mythology of Charlemagne, a somewhat of a understatement of the problems he had going through becoming king, or a combination of the two, because it mentions in Book 7, Chapter 15, and apparently Chapter 36, that the battle was on October 14th.
Uh-huh.
But he's not elected and crowned until Christmas Day, which is... two months later. It's either it's either kind of glossing over something he had to do to consolidate his hold, or they're purposely linking it up to Charlemagne becoming being crowned emperor in 800 on Christmas Day.
They are. They're linking it up with Charlemagne. They're referring to Charlemagne there. But he had to go through the rituals that an English king always goes through. The acclamation and election by clergy and people, the designation by the previous king. And
seems so. Almost like a sacrament.
It is a sacrament. Yeah.
Well, I was going to say, how far is Hastings from London? Because there's travel time, and if it's winter, it's going to take some time.
Okay, Hastings is in the south. It's quite a ways, actually. It's quite a ways in the south.
So feasibly, it could take
London,
at least
months,
a month.
Is quite reasonable for him to get with an army, with a whole army. They're all traveling, but he camped outside of the city. He didn't actually attack any other cities. He did fight a battle with the Londoners, but once they gave in and accepted him, and then. Actually, it doesn't say who crowned him here, but later it says the Archbishop of York crowned him. All the sources say the Archbishop of York crowned him.
And December 21st is also seen in those times as the beginning of the year. Seems like calendar begins then. Or
The calendar often began in the spring, actually, the beginning of the year. Yeah, it would begin at different times. Well, I think we've covered quite a bit of the Norman side. We spent a long time on the Norman side of the story. So next week, we're going to look at the English side much more briefly, and then we're going to look at how William set up the new government in England and how he ordered the country and turned it into his own private kingdom. So we'll see you next week.
Hasn't the North always given you...